Jesus, everybody is healed in the name of Jesus. Everybody is the head and not the tail in the name of Jesus. Before you sit down, encourage somebody on your row and tell them you have the victory in Jesus' name. Come on, tell them with victory in your voice, you have the victory in Jesus' name. Come on, tell them you have the victory in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, if you believe that, give God a shout of praise. Glory to God. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Come on, put those hands together. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Oh, victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. If I need joy, come on. Give God some praise. if you can. Well, we bless the Lord on this afternoon. This is a day that the Lord has made, and we can all rejoice and be glad in it. So glad to see each and every one of you today, and we thank God for you, and we appreciate the presence of the Lord in this room. We want to thank God for all of our servant ministry team helping to facilitate this service. God bless you. We thank God for your prayers, and we also thank God for all of the giving that you gave on today. And this ministry is supported by your prayers and by your financial support. We want you to know we appreciate it. And for those who are watching at home, too, we appreciate you from different parts of the nation. Certainly, we thank God for the prayer team who have been helping out down at the summer celebration, the Indiana Black Expo. We've prayed for dozens and dozens and dozens of people since Friday. And we believe that our city, our state, and our nation is the better because you have been praying. So we thank God for you. And we certainly thank God for all of you who have been praying for Pastor D and I. And we're celebrating 22 years of marriage this last week. July the 17th, 22 years ago, after a very short courtship. Amen. We're still together. Amen. And it doesn't seem like 22 years. You know, sometimes you can be married and 22 years seem like 22 years. Y'all ain't have to say nothing, but it don't seem like 22 years. It's been a wonderful, wonderful journey, and believe in God for more years on the way. Amen. I want you to turn with me to Matthew 28, verse 19. I don't know that this message today will make you want to run and shout and knock over chairs and all of that, but I believe that you'll be blessed as we move through here. We've been talking about the Word of God for the past several weeks, and we engaged our congregation in a challenge to read the Bible, the New Testament in particular, for 3 months. 9 chapters a day. There's 260 chapters in the New Testament. And if we were to read 9 chapters every day, we would cover the New Testament every 30 days. And so we're in the second of the 30-day period, July. And I trust that you all have been reading and or listening to the Bible, and that it has been a blessing to you and your family. August will be our last month for doing it corporately. Subsequent to that, I pray that you would continue reading your Bible over and over and over again and studying it. Reading is one thing, but to study it is altogether something different. So we want to do both. But one of the things I believe that happens after that we get the Word of God down in our hearts is that now we are prepared and we are empowered to share with someone else what we have read. And one of the things that God gave me to do during this Word series, and we've had some awesome, awesome teaching and preaching where the Word of God is concerned. This past Wednesday, Minister Wilson blessed us with the Word of God. It was just tremendous dealing with the Word of God. And I want to continue on in that same vein, dealing with the Word of God, but instead of saying to you that you need to read it and study it, that's important, but now you need to tell somebody else about it. You want to tell somebody else about what you have learned. So there in Matthew 28 and 19, I'm going to read it from the New International Version, which is a more contemporary rendering of the King James Version. It says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And I'm more interested right now with the first part of that. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations. And slowing it down even more, therefore go and make disciples. And I want to talk from the subject on this afternoon just for a few minutes, winning souls and making disciples. Winning souls and making disciples. I got saved, or I received Jesus as my personal Savior when I was 10. I can remember that. And I'm 48 now, so I've been saved for a long time. But I have not been a Christian all my life. I have not been a Christian since I was 10. I got saved when I was 10. In other words, I received Jesus as my personal Savior according to Romans 10 and 9. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And so I received Jesus, I believed on Jesus, and so I got saved. But it has been a long journey in becoming a disciple. Discipleship has all to do with being taught, you being taught, how to live and to be like Jesus Christ. Because I think you would agree with me that everybody who say they saved don't act like Jesus. Now y'all complain like y'all know what I'm talking about, because I know all y'all act like Jesus every day. And for those of you who consider yourself church folk, you know everybody who say they saved, they saved, but they don't act like Jesus. And we're going to make it plain over these next few weeks, and I hope that you'll come back. We ain't going to beat you up or anything like that. But I want you to be clear on the differentiating factors of what it means to be saved and to be a Christian. Because according to John 8 and 31, Jesus said, if you continue in my word. So step one is to believe on him, to receive him as your personal Savior. Now something supernatural takes place. Now you are saved. And people will say, well, saved from what? How many of you all who have shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with others and you've told them they need to be saved, they say, well, saved from what? Well, there's an afterlife. When you die, we are three-part being. We are spirits. We possess a soul. We live in a physical body. When the physical body dies, then the real part of you called your spirit lives on. So you have an everlasting spirit. The body which you live in, this flesh body, is for the here and now. But when this body can no longer sustain your spirit and soul, the Bible says all souls return to God. So what happens to you after this life? Well, you will either have an everlasting life in heaven and or hell. Those are two real places. Now, I got saved at 10 because I didn't want to go to hell. And back then, the preachers of the word of God, they were real rough on that hell part. I mean, they would say things like, you better give your life to Jesus Christ because you could leave here today and get hit by a bus. I mean, they had some real horror stories. And you were afraid. So, you know, they talked about hell in such a way, you just didn't want to go there. Now I know you have to get acclimated to this, because most time you go to church, you don't hear about heaven and hell. Hell's not a cuss word. It's a real place. Are you hearing what I'm saying? But with everything that's going on in our nation and across the world, we need to hear more about this. So I ain't worried about whether or not people are going to give their tithe and offering, whether we're going to fill the house. I used to be worried about that. You know, we got chairs stacked up. I used to be worried about all that. We stream our service. I used to be worried about empty chairs. And God said, forget about that. Because at the end of the day, people out here dying, and they never heard about Jesus. A few scattering hand claps of support on that. And after the jobs program, which the Lord supernaturally blessed us to do for the young people, that's a hard job. We had 13 or 14 adults with 200 young people. And the Lord put me out in the middle of all that to lead that. That's a hard job. And then the Lord gave us almost $50,000 to run the program. And we didn't ask for most of that. Except we asked God, and God raised up people who gave it to us. And then God told me, I want you to do it all across the American Midwest region, which includes two states, 12 states. So the American Midwest region is 12 states. You got Minnesota, you got Detroit, you got Iowa, you got Nebraska, you got all these different states, North Dakota, South Dakota, you got Michigan, you got Detroit, you got Indiana, you got Illinois, and Chicago is the largest city in the American Midwest region, and Chicago's like a war zone. Since January 1, moving away from Chicago, coming right here home, since January 1 this year, 250 people have been shot in the city of Indianapolis. And out of that number, about 60 of them died. And they say the only reason why 250 are not dead is just depends on where the bullet lands. And I often wonder how many of those individuals who died knew about Jesus. And I work a lot with police officers, and the police officers tell me that when they go to the crime scene, they're just so heart torn, and those young men, many of them are young men, are dying in their arms. And they don't want to die. It might be hard before the bullet come, but after the bullet come, they don't want to die. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so we have churches all across our cities, and churches, you can go to Indianapolis, you can go to Chicago, you can go to Cleveland, Ohio, you can go to all these different places, and we have beautiful churches in our neighborhoods, and the majority of people who live in the neighborhoods do not know Jesus Christ. We got work to do. There are a lot of kids in our Christian school and daycare who never read a Bible and never been inside a church. And the fact that they're not coming means we got to go get them. There are people on your job that have never heard about Jesus Christ. And then the question is, can they see him in you? I was telling my wife the other day, I said, you know, there are no differentiations between Christians and the people of the world nowadays. You can't hardly tell. And yet the Bible says we come out from among them and we're to be separate. And now you can't hardly tell anymore. But if that's going to change, we got to go get the people. And we got to share the gospel with them. The gospel means good news. That word gospel, it means good news. Tell somebody to share the good news. This week, my prayer for you is that you will go out and share the good news about what Jesus has done with you and for you with somebody else. That you would on your job, that you would at the grocery store, that you would with wherever you go, share the good news of Jesus Christ with somebody else. In fact, you might start with your own family members. And that's a challenge. Think about it. How many of us have won a soul to Jesus Christ this year? You don't have to raise your hand. From the pastor all the way out to the parking lot, we all should be winning souls for the kingdom. I'm believing God that this year we can say we won 50 souls, solid. Are you hearing me? So this is the charge that Jesus gave to the people. He said, go and make disciples of all nations. And so, God, we want to be able to do that even in the 21st century. God gets excited, not because we can preach good. God gets excited, not because we can teach good. God gets excited, and heaven gets excited, not because we can sing so well, not because we can do all these things. God gets excited, not because you have a master's degree in theology or a doctorate in theology. God gets excited when people get saved. Look at Luke 15 and 7 in the New International Version. It says, I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not repent. And maybe that's where the churches got that whole concept of bringing one chair down front and saying, is there one? One person giving their lives to Jesus Christ gets all heaven rejoicing. There's shouts in heaven. There's rejoicing in heaven. There's a celebration in heaven when one person gets saved. And we ought to get excited about it. Thank God when we get healed. Thank God when we can pay off a mortgage. Thank God when we get a job. Thank God when we can do all that. But God doesn't get excited because you get a house or a car or because you get married or anything like that. That's supposed to happen. But heaven rejoices when somebody's life is changed and converted and somebody received Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, because that is the reason why God sent his only begotten Son. That's the whole purpose for everything. It's about winning souls and making disciples. And when you get to heaven, you're going to be rewarded based on the souls you won. Now, sometimes you don't have to say anything to win people to Jesus Christ. Because all of us, we don't have that capacity in our personality just to straight up and walk up to somebody and start witnessing to them. That's an evangelistic gift. But all of us have it in our personality to talk about what God did for us. And there, all of us have a testimony of where God brought us from, what God brought us out of. There were some things that if it had not been for the Lord who was on your side, you wouldn't be sitting right here right now. The devil tried to take you out, but God blocked it. Tell somebody about it. You were in a bad relationship, and God kept you while you were in that relationship. There are people who were in relationships like you were in that they didn't come out of it, but God brought you out of it. Tell somebody about that and give God the credit. There are miracles that you have experienced in your life when the doctor looked at you and said it wasn't going to happen for you, or you just had a week or a month to live, and God flipped that thing, and here you are today. You need to tell somebody about that. Tell your neighbor, somebody needs your testimony. John said they overcame him, talking about Satan, by the blood of the Lamb. We have already overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their testimony. You got a testimony. And for many of you, there's a testimony being worked out in your life even as I'm speaking. I want to say to every person going through something in this room, in just a little while, it's just going to be another testimony. Everything that you go through, everything that you face in your life, God already knew that you were going to have to face it, and God already knew that you could handle it. It's just another testimony, because there's somebody that God is going to put you in front of who needs to hear what you got to say. In fact, there's some stuff you're going through right now, and people see you going through it, and you're going through it not like other people have gone through it, but you're going through it by faith, and you're enduring that thing as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, and somebody is being encouraged by looking at you. People can get saved with words, and they can get saved without words. And what I mean by that, Paul said, to the unmarried women, he said, your husband, your unbelieving husband can be saved without the word. And I said, God, how can an unbelieving husband be saved without the word through the wife? He said, by the life. It's by the life you live. And every single day, and the reason why I read my Bible and spend time in prayer, because I want to make sure that I'm living about what I'm talking about. See, we can say that we love Jesus. We can say that we are Christians. But at the end of the day, it's not based on what you say. It's based on how you live. That's what God is looking at. And I want to make sure day in and day out, week in and week out, month in and month out, year in and year out, that I'm living this book, walking it out. Come on, tell somebody, walk it out, walk it out. And in the 21st century, it's a little more difficult to do because so many things are changing in our society that which used to be wrong now doesn't seem to be so wrong. You might not come back, so let me preach to you while you're here. You said, Pastor, you're going to have a streaming ministry. But God told me, tell the people. Now I'm a real prophet. You hear what I'm saying? Our current police chief, I said, you're going to be, we went to Washington, D.C. together about 3-4 years ago. I said, you're going to be the police chief for 18 months. He's a month overdue. He's trying to figure out what he's going to do right now. And I'm going to meet up with him again and tell him what God told me. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That's what this is all about. Man, I said, God, I don't just want to read that book. I don't just want to hear what you said can be done in that book. Let it be demonstrated in our lives. Kanye can get a good house. Kim Kardashian can get a new car without Jesus. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Lil' Kim and them, Slick Willie, Waka Flocka, all of them, they can get it without Jesus because they got money. But there are some things money cannot buy. None of them can lay hands on the sick and the sick recover. You can drive up in a beat-up car and lay hands on somebody they love and get them healed without a dime in your pocket. But I tell you one thing, you might go in broke, but you ain't gonna leave out of there broke. What the world needs now is to see the power of God in demonstration and in power. Thank God for the doctors. Thank God for the nurses. Thank God for the medicine, because they can't do what they do unless they do it by the power of God anyway. Medicine ain't new. Jesus made some on the spot for a man who had a blind eye. Wish I had the recipe to that salve. It had spit in it. Jesus spit. Two parts Jesus spit, one part dirt, healed eyes. If I went out there and spit in some mud and put it on your eyes, you say that's nasty, and you couldn't get healed. Because we so classy now. We so dignified now. Are you hearing what I'm saying? But to really see the power of God in demonstration and power, we got to forget about everything that's us and say, God, according to 2 Chronicles 20, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. If you don't do it, it won't be done. How many believe he can do it? People on your job need to see the power of God working in your life. People on your job know you just lost your house. They know you just lost your loved one. They know you're going through all these problems. They know you just went home and had one of them red or orange stickers on your door. That's the eviction notice. And you didn't let that phase you. I remember years ago I had a red Subaru sport model. And instead of making the payment, I went on vacation. How many of y'all ever done that? I'm going on vacation, man. And I took Subaru's money and had me a good time. It was a good vacation. And when I got home, they hired somebody to come and get their car. And I looked through the peephole. And the guy said, I got to take the car. I said, I ain't letting you have it. He said, I can take it. Anyway. And I felt bad. I gave him the keys. See, I could have acted up. But people in my apartment area, they knew I was a Christian. I could have made a scene. Y'all know what I'm talking about. It ain't even a car. You in the restaurant making the scene over half-cooked meat. I mean, you shutting the whole place down, and the people know you a Christian. See, how are we going to win people to Jesus Christ when we lose it? See, you on the job, and they fire you for no reason or for a reason, and you just put a virus on all the computers. They ain't pay me what I'm worth anyway. I'm going to show them before I get out of here. Security got to come and get you. And they got you on both arms. And you, they go evangelist so-and-so. No, we don't roll like that. Because no matter what happened, we the people of God. Amen? It's good what I'm trying to tell you. 1 Timothy 2 and 4, New International Version says, God wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. So he wants everybody to be saved. And if everybody going to get saved, it's going to have to happen through you. Come on, tell somebody it's going to happen through you. Just think about it. If all of us won one soul to Jesus Christ this week, look how many souls will be saved. Just one. Just one. If all of us shared the gospel with somebody else, if all of us this week for the next 6 days just shared our testimony with someone or just live right before people, look how many people would come to Jesus Christ. It can happen. Somebody help me say it can happen. In John 3 and 16, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that is the essence of salvation. God loves us so much that he gave his only son, his only one, his beloved son. Now, it's one thing if you got 4 or 5 kids and they asked you to give up one, you'd be like, let me see. Lord, in the name of Jesus. Because you got 4 more after that. But your only child, and many of you all have been an only child, and God gave his only begotten son because he loves us. The Bible says God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Jesus Christ died for us. So it wasn't that we were his friends. It was not that we loved him, but he loved us before we ever knew him. He knew we were going to be doing all the stuff that we have done and are doing. And nevertheless, he gave his only son so that we could have everlasting life. And when Jesus comes, or if we die before he comes and we die in the Lord, we shall reign forever with him. And I don't know about you, but it's not about casting out devils. That's good. It's not about all of that, because when the disciples came back, they were excited about the fact that they were casting out devils and they were healing people and they were raising the dead, and Jesus played it off. He said, that ain't what you should be excited about, but be excited about the fact that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you can't get excited about nothing else this week, get excited about the fact that your name is already in the book in heaven, and that if Jesus comes or you die today, that you will reign forever in heaven. You ought to give God praise for the fact that your name is already written in the book above. That's good news right there. That's good news right there. Especially in this world we're living in. One person can make a difference. Look at somebody and say, one person can make a difference. One person can make a difference. iPhones, iWatches, iPads, Androids that came after iPads and iPhones. That difference was made by one man, Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs came up with these concepts, and he put people around him who came up with these ideas. And my wife and I were talking the other day, and when we got married, there were no cell phones. They had the car phone. You had to carry it around with you. It was like a big old satchel. And the going thing was not the cell phone or the car phone. It was the pager. Everybody thought they was something with a pager. You know, they had pagers. But Apple came up with the iPhone, and it changed everything. Before that, you had the Motorola flip phone and all that. But the smartphone, the computer in your pocket, was a concept. And it changed the whole world. And that concept that became a reality has been evangelized on television, billboards, magazines. I mean, it has been massive evangelism and has taken it around the world. And now in every major nation, there are smartphones. And they have done what God wants us to do. And that is to evangelize the entire city and let them know that there is a better way and there is a better life. But in order for it to work, you have to be excited about being saved. You have to be excited about being a Christian. Is there anybody here excited about that? You get up in the morning, you ought to be excited about the fact that God has given you another day to go tell somebody about Jesus Christ. Yeah, you got some problems. Yeah, you got some challenges. Yeah, there's some things going on. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers us out of them all. And the reason why that's in the book, in the psalm, is because when you wake up with challenges, you already know you are an overcomer. In fact, you are more than an overcomer through the God who has saved you. I'm going to close with this right here in Mark 5 and 18. Are you getting anything out of this? I'm not going to go through all of this story, but Jesus comes to a city where there's a herd of swine. And the demons are cast out and they get in the swine. And the swine or the pigs go over the cliff. And there was a man, the man who the swine came out of. I want you to see this because I think a lot of times we miss this part. Many people know about the swine and how the demons went into them and how they were drowned in the water. Many people know that story. But there's something more significant in this chapter than what happened to the bacon. When Jesus got back into the boat, verse 18, New Living Translation, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go too. In other words, he had got his deliverance and he wanted to go with Jesus. If we were to try and understand how to apply that to today's time, it would be the equivalent of somebody getting saved and all they want to do is stay in the church. All they want to do is work in the church. And I was telling the 9 o'clock crowd, you know, I'm a fisherman, and years ago when we came out here and we built a house over in Winding Ridge, over on Pauly's Court, and we had a freezer in the garage. And every time I would go fishing, we would bring the fish, I would bring the fish and put it in the freezer. And I used to keep all the fish. Wasn't no catch and release. I mean, if I caught you, I was keeping you. Young fishermen. And I thought every fish was a big fish. And we lived there, I guess, 5 years or something like that. And then we moved. And when we moved, the freezer was full of fish. See, we caught the fish, but we never cleaned the fish. And I'm concerned in the 21st century that the church is catching fish, but we're not cleaning the fish. See, catching the fish is one thing, but cleaning the fish is discipleship, because that takes a little more work. I mean, you got to cut down in there, and how many of you all have ever been around somebody cleaning the fish? I mean, that is just, and especially if the fish is still a little, got a little life in it. I mean, you just don't even like that. That's just nasty. You know, cleaning fish is just nasty. You got to cut down in there, you know, and then get all the guts out of there and all that stuff and pull all that out and throw it and, you know, get it all out of there. And then you got the fish head you're scaring the kids with and all that. I mean, that's just a nasty job, fish cleaning. And I think in the church, Sister Angela, we got a bunch of fish that are frozen. The freezer is full of fish. But if the fish were discipled, if the fish were clean, are you hearing what I'm saying? If the fish were clean, we see more fish. Because then we go out and we do what was done to us. And that's make disciples. So this man, he wanted to be with Jesus. He wanted to stick close to Jesus. But watch what Jesus tells him. He says, no, go home to your friends and tell them what wonderful things the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been. So the man started off to visit the 10 towns of that region and began to tell everyone about the great things Jesus had done for him. And everyone was amazed at what he told them. There's 1.1 million people that live in the Metroplex area around Indianapolis. It would be the equivalent of this man going out and telling everybody about what Jesus did for him. And then next Sunday, when we show up for church, 1.1 million people would be outside. The whole city was changed by one man. And it wasn't just in that particular occasion, but you remember the woman who sat by the well when Jesus ministered to her, and she went to her city and told everybody in the city what Jesus had done for her. And the Bible says the whole city came out to meet him. I wonder what would happen if all of us went out this week and shared our testimony and shared the good news with somebody else in our neighborhood, with somebody on the job, with somebody at the cleaners, with somebody at the restaurant, with somebody at the beauty shop, with somebody at the barber shop. I'll tell you what would happen. Lives would be changed and people would come to Jesus Christ, and the house of God and the people of God would be blessed because of the evangelistic power that is flowing through your life right now. Give somebody a high five and shout go. Oh, come on, that was a little puny. Come on, tell them, shout, go! It's time for us to go out and to get them and to bring them in. Not just so the house can be full. That is one purpose of it. Because Jesus said, I want my house to be full. That's just one part of it. But it is God's will that no flesh perish, but that all men be saved. And if people are going to be saved, they have to get saved through us. If people are going to be delivered, they have to get delivered through us. People can be saved through signs and miracles and wonders. What would happen if everybody on your job got healed because you prayed for them? What if everybody on your job got a word from God because God was speaking through you? What if people on your job, they came to you with prayer requests for their children, for their families, for their husbands, for their finances, and because you prayed about it or because you spoke to God about it, it happened because you said it. That's the power of God working through you. And then people want to know who you serve. People want to know, what is it about you that's so different? And in order for that to happen, we have to start living what we've read about. You say, I got some problems, but I'm delivered. I got some situations going on in my life, but it's going to be all right. God's going to bring me out. I'm learning every day how to live out the word that I read. And there's some stuff that happened, I don't even respond to it. I used to respond to just about everything. I'm learning how I'm not even responding to that. Access denied. I'm the kind of person, once I respond to it, I get too deep into it. So some stuff, now some of y'all not like that. Y'all, you know, it don't matter what goes on. You ain't have nothing to do with it anyway. But there are those of you that when something happens, the more you get involved, the more you get involved, the more you get involved, and before you know it, you have fallen all the way from where you've been working on. Man, you've been reading the Bible all of July, and you pumped up, and you worded up, and you faithed up, and here comes something. You read the Bible all in June, and here comes something in July, and you fall off the place you had. Because you let it get to you. As close as you try to get to God, the enemy is always going to try to come in and put a wedge there. Because the devil don't want you getting close to God. He don't want you getting close to God because he knows the closer that you get to God, the more powerful you become. The scripture said, if you draw close to him, he'll draw close to you. Let me tell you what happens as you get close to God. See, God is light, and in him dwells no darkness at all. And it's my understanding that the closer you get to the speed of light, time slows down. Time, there's timelessness in the speed of light. The closer you get to that light, the time just begins to slow down. And that is how they will be able to send men to Mars and place like that, because they'll get closer and closer and closer to the speed of light. But God, he is already light. And so as you begin to move closer to him, now you begin to dwell into the supernatural. And not only that, but all of the virtues of God, love, peace, joy, long-suffering, all those different virtues, all the divine provisions, the closer you get to him, the more access you have to all of that supernatural provision. So the devil knows that if you get close to God, all your needs will be met. The devil knows if you get close to God, your body will get healed. The devil knows that if you get close to God, your life will be dramatically changed. So he tries to keep you as far away from God as he possibly can. It's all of this interference that's happening in your life that's trying to keep you away from God. When you get close to God, supernatural things begin to happen. Come on, tell somebody, stay close to him. Stay close to him. Stay close to him. That is why you can have peace that passeth all understanding. You're right in the middle of the storm, but you're not worried about what's going on. Have you ever known somebody, it was thundering and lightning outside, and the hail was falling down, and the torrential rains were coming down, and they were not afraid, and they were just sitting there eating a hot dog or their bologna sandwich, and they were not worried about what was going on around them? That's peace. And God said, I'll give you the same kind of peace if you get close to me. It can be hailing in your life, it can be raining in your life, it can be thundering in your life, and you're not worried about it because you're close to God. Give somebody a high five and shout, get close to him. Getting close to him. Getting close to him. That's what we're doing. Getting close to God. Becoming more Christ-like. That's the key. I want to be a Christian. I don't just want to be saved. I'm going to heaven. I'm saved from eternal damnation. Eternal damnation is hell. I'm saved from that. But I don't just want to be saved. I want to be a Christian. Because God don't need me in heaven right now. He don't need a doorkeeper. He don't need a song director. He don't need another minister, bishop, apostle, and evangelist in heaven. He needs you right here now. And I said, God, since you need me now, I'm going to make myself useful. Because I never want God to say, well, I don't need you on heaven now, on earth now either. I want to be, to some degree, indispensable when it comes to living down here. Because I'm doing so much work for God, healing so many people, laying hands on people. I mean, doing great things for God in the earth realm, that God said, I think I'll leave you down there a little while longer because you're doing something. That's why we're here. Come on, tell somebody, that's why you're here. That's why you're here. You are here to work for God. There are things you can do that nobody else can do. There's an anointing on your life that's not on other folks' life. There's something about what you have the power to do that nobody else has the power to do. There's a gifting in you that nobody else has. There's an ability in you that nobody else has. And when you tap into the ability that God has given you, not only are other people blessed, but you are also blessed. And I tell people all the time, throw yourself into the work God has given you to do. I tell unmarried people, you want to get married? Start working for God. Just start working for him. Be at the 9 o'clock service. be at the 11:30 service. Yeah, I hear you. And say, Pastor, whatever you want me to do, I'll do it. I mean, wipe the windows down. I mean, just do whatever. I mean, whatever. Just looking for stuff to do in the house of the Lord. I mean, you there 150% of the time. And I promise you, in the first 30 days, folk going to be asking for your phone number. Do you want to go to the movies? Would you like to go to dinner? Why? Because every time you get sold out to God, a distraction comes. Now, marriage is a distraction, but it's a good distraction. Y'all know I'm right. Y'all read it in the Bible. Y'all reading, right? Paul said marriage is a distraction, but it's a good distraction. But if you're not married, you got plenty of time to do stuff for God. And on social media, I always see folk posting stuff, I'm bored. I need all the bored people to meet me at 8 o'clock Sunday morning, and I promise you, you will be bored no more again forever. Come on, stand to your feet. Glory to God. Come on, stand to your feet. Glory to God. Ain't no boredom in the kingdom. There's a lot of work to do. Brother, stand back. The harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. He said, well, he said, if I get involved in ministry and church, God will give me a husband. Yeah, he'll do it. Because I said it. Yeah, he'll do it. It's in the book. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And you got time to do stuff for the Lord. And you might get so busy for God that you say, hey, I'm not ready yet. Are you hearing me? See, if I wasn't married to this woman right here, I'd be all over the world preaching. I'd preach here on Sunday. I'd jump on a jet, and I'd be all over the place because I ain't got to get permission. You can't do that when you're married unless she's going to come with me. And at this season of her life, she don't like doing all that traveling. Are you hearing me? Now, as we get older, we'll be all over the place. Because I want her with me. Amen. Are you understanding what I'm saying? But there's something for all of us to do. And I just want you to think about as we pray what you're supposed to be doing. Because, see, I can't really tell you what you're supposed to be doing. In fact, I think you already know. I think you already know what you're supposed to be doing. But it's about doing it. And my prayer for every person in this room is that you would be involved in ministry. I call this the interior ministry and the exterior ministry. I'm involved in both. And after we finished the jobs program on Friday, I went to take care of some business at the bank. And on the way back, I stopped at the bank.